funny. The Rock is actually he's super entertaining. He got nominated for best.
No way.
Best action comedy actor, whatever.
That's so good. Good for him. Mm-hmm. Because
that guy's putting in work,
and it shows.
he's everywhere. Right. I can't wait for Baywatch.
What? No, come on. You don't want to watch Baywatch.
I'll watch Baywatch. I'll watch the
shit
out of
Baywatch. That's an abomination. They're just putting people in it. What are they going to do? Imagine the best Baywatch movie you can watch, right?
I've never watched a single episode of Baywatch.
I can't say I've seen a single episode. From what I understand, there's like scantily dressed people and somebody drowns and you go in there and you save them and the lifeguards have drama. How good can this movie get? Like what do we...
Okay, all right. First of all, get on the mic.
Okay.
Right up in there.
I'll get right up on there.
Thank you, bro.
Sound like Yasin. Hello.
That's one thing. Second thing is how many hospital dramas are out? And
hospitals are dramatic, right? There's somebody dying. Dude, there's a baby being born.
It's got to get to a point where it's like saturated. But they still keep making new stuff.
We're making the beach dramatic. That's the thing. Baywatch. Like, they're trying to sell, like, oh, you got to watch this water.
I have no idea what the movie's going to be about.
Okay.
But I can tell you right now
that
they can make it, they can make the beach dramatic. Here's one. Here's a pitch. Okay, yeah, shark, obviously.
Or literally a bitch, like a dog and just running after people.
Drug dealers. Drug runners.
Right.
Right? They need to bring the drugs onto the... Like they, you know, it's coming from wherever it's coming from.
Yeah,
from the sea.
That's true.
and then they gotta do it. And then these Baywatch. They're watching the bays, and then they're like, "Look, the cops are not gonna do what we need to do."
Right.
Right. We need to take matters in our own hands. Right.
Grab your floaty.
Right.
Put on your shorts.
Just everyone with boobs, men with boobs, women with boobs.
Yeah.
And The Rock has boobs.
Right? No, I know. He's got boobs for days.
Yeah, his boobs enter the room before he does.
I think that's what's in his biceps. Probably, right? Boobs shoved everywhere. That guy's not right. That guy's not right, by the way.
Oh, he's super right, man. I'm a big fan of the people. What is it called? What is he called? The people's rock? Is that what it is?
No, I think it's the people's elbow.
Oh, okay.
That's all right, though. That's okay. But the thing is, if he wasn't so friggin' pleasant, right? If you take the personality out, you're like, what the hell is this? He just kept bigger?
In fact, he got smaller. Didn't he get smaller from his wrestling days?
That's still relative. No, he was much smaller when he wrestled.
Oh, okay.
So when he was 15 years old, you can Google this, the guy has a mustache. And he looks like a grown 30-year-old man.
Yeah, it's also a very dirty mustache.
It's a dirty pedo mustache. But once he got done with wrestling and he got into acting, he just started exploding.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it's a good move. He's happier, apparently, not having to jump off of things and land on his head.
Oh, okay.
What happened?
There's a Vice documentary about the most violent wrestling championship. Wrestling.
Yeah, we could talk about it. Something. I've seen parts of that, man. I can stomach that thing.
I watched the whole thing. I was friggin' transfixed. Geez. Because I was like, oh, okay, so they're gonna do tricks. Right? Mm-hmm. So like, it's like, oh, there's tacks, but the tacks are made out of gummy like material.
Yeah,
no. Everything is real. Yeah. The blood is real. Yeah. The pain is real. They're going through actual sheets of glass. They're actually body slamming on real brass tacks.
It's like, hey, John, everybody's going to think that you actually broke something. Oh yeah, how are we going to do that? We're going to make you break something.
And these guys are serious. They love this. First of all, the crowd is just rabid for incredible amount of violence. But even the performers take this as like, this is an honor for me to do this.
Right.
Right? For me to put my life on the line and get beat. And there's a huge mutual respect amongst all of these guys.
They have it in their head, like the lineage of like, we're carrying on the torch of people who've done this in the past.
Right.
It's like, oh, it's just an honor to be here. Go fly off of this. Like it's
not only just the flying. It's the, here's a baseball bat that's wrapped around with barbed wire. Mm-hmm. I want you to take this and hit it hard into that guy's arm, stomach, back.
Yeah.
And and blood's everywhere. Jeez. They're like, there was that thing where it was like, it's like this circle with like spikes on it on a piece of wood.
Yep.
And I think it's supposed to use it to fasten tarp onto something. Like you nail it through something. And so one guy One guy, they one wrestler takes it and puts it on the skull of another guy, and then takes a bat and then bashes him in the head. Wow. So this thing gets stuck in his scalp. Mm-hmm. So it's done and everything, right? The you know, there's a winner and a loser. That part is scripted. And then you, the Vice covers, like, obviously you're getting, get the behind the scene, right? So the guy who has the thing stuck in his head, he's just sitting there. And then there's another guy with pliers,
mm-hmm.
and they're gripping the thing and they're pulling it.
Yeah, that's where I
and
stopped watching.
As he's pulling
that.
It, you can see like all of his skin just like lift up, yeah. and like blood's dripping, right. and all that. And he's just taking it. He's, yeah. like, "All right, here we go. All right, no, just do what." And he's not flinching. And I'm like, "Oh, okay, maybe some alcohol, maybe some drugs are involved, but these people are beasts for them to be able to take that much damage."
Why are we still watching this kind of, not as you and me, but like people coming in and they're like, "Oh, I hope somebody gets one of these things plastered in their head."
Yeah.
And they're like, that's what you want to see.
Apparently that's what the level of violence. There was a point where the Vice camera, mm-hmm. had blood on it. Like it splattered off of the thing and it landed on the camera. This is getting
uncomfortable listening to you. Like I've just been rubbing my arms.
And while I'm watching it, I'm like, I can't believe that there's people for this. Yeah. And the only way that they can make it work is that they have it in a farm somewhere,
right?
Somewhere in the middle of nowhere,
no regulation,
yeah, and just zero safety laws to like, it's ridiculous.
So how much of a vacuum of entertainment does your town need before this seems like a good idea? You're like, let's go down to the barn.
People come from nationwide. They have, yeah. this every year, and this is the pinnacle. There is no other more violent, more visceral wrestling tournament, like, and this is, yeah. you know, like you know, professional wrestling.
Right. You used, right. to watch this stuff growing up?
Never.
Never? Your dad? Dude, my dad, we used to go to the Blockbuster and get the newest ones that we missed on pay-per-view.
Really?
We used to watch them. And then at some point it dawned on us. This shit may not be real. Cold, like immediately, like, we've been lied to. Because we were so impressed.
Okay.
He was buying into it, mm-hmm. but he was like, yeah, they probably fight. Mm-hmm. But, and I was like, they must fight. Look how big they are. I'd fight if I was that big. So, yeah. And then we stopped completely.
Okay.
But I can't get over the fact that people want to see this. Like, people get up and get excited about seeing this. So,
yeah.
But then again, like, I saw, I don't know if you saw, you probably didn't watch the Maple Leafs game yesterday, but they just started fighting. Mm-hmm. And it wasn't like a normal fight. Like, people hit each other with, like, one guy jousted another guy with a stick, meaning mm-hmm. went full speed and just hit him with a stick in a way where he didn't have to swing it. He just, like, braced hit against his own body and just speared this guy. Like, even me, I was like, bro, like, some medieval time shit. Like, but that's the kind of stuff we like to see every now and then.
Okay.
It makes you feel alive.
So...
So anything can happen.
So for some reason, yeah. I'm a fan of the UFC.
Sure.
I like watching fights, but I couldn't, the wrestling was a little too much for me.
Sure.
There was a point where I was like, come on, guys.
Mm-hmm.
There's other ways to make money. And it's not even that much money.
Right. It's nothing.
They were making like almost peanuts.
Mm-hmm.
And when they're done, they're like, you know, thank you for breaking that on my head. You know, like, thank you. That was really cool, man. And they're all like hugging each other. Again, this like sense of camaraderie and brotherhood. I get it. That part of it I get, but I just don't understand.
Well, this is for pure entertainment, but it's for, I know sports are for pure entertainment, but don't get me wrong. Mm-hmm. I understand that there's really nothing at stake in terms of people's lives, but there's a lot of money and pride and it's a business.
Yeah.
There's very little money involved in this. There is a lot of history, but people are perfectly fine to hurt themselves for this and pay money to watch. Like, I would have a hard time paying money to encourage two people getting concussions.
Mm-hmm.
I say this, and then we have UFC tickets. So I should stop drawing lines in the sand, I guess.
Yeah, that's. You know? I think that's why I was.
I watch football, I watch hockey, I watch MMA, a ton of it, you know? So who am I to say? But I just feel like that's not even a sport. I'm like, this is a sport. So like, why does you calling it a sport make it acceptable?
I feel like the wrestling is more of an entertainment thing than a sport. Yeah, I mean, there's definite skill, but it's like, right. Like stuntman skill.
Yeah, yeah, no, I agree. But like, then MMA is also an entertainment thing, almost more than it's just as much. It's more of a spectacle than, you know, your organized sports like your team sports that you have.
Mm-hmm. All right.
What?
No, nothing. This is like I got another thing.
Okay, tell me.
So a couple of days ago, I was on Instagram, as I do, and National Geographic posted a picture of a bird. It's a black herring. It's a black herring. Okay. Heron. Black heron.
You're pronouncing herring wrong.
Really?
No.
H-E-R-O-N-S?
Right. You're doing it right. I was wrong earlier.
Well, yeah. Heron.
Sure.
Black heron. And what he does, or she, is stands really still in like a in a body of water.
Right. Right. Like obviously, a lake?
No. I mean, the bird is like this big, so it can't be super deep, right?
So like swampy water with some leaves.
Yeah. Like a pond of some sort.
And what Yasin did to the people now watching the video, he like drew out, a 2.5 foot tall bird, would you say?
Yeah, something along those lines. I think including sticks, which are his feet.
And this is like a flamingo almost, like long legs, but yeah, black bird.
One of those good things. Yeah, but like not as big as a flamingo. Anyway, so the way how it hunts is super interesting. It takes its wings and then makes an umbrella over the water, and that casts a shadow in the water. And for some reason, fish are attracted to a shadow, so they come towards it. Which for some reason doesn't make sense, because like if you're seeing a shadow of a bird, wouldn't you just like go the other way? Because that genetic, I mean, you know, through evolution, that generally meant that you were gonna get eaten. Whatever. I digress. after he does this, he's looking down. This also blocks out the reflections in the water,
right?
Which allows him to see right to the bottom.
Diabolical.
Find the fish, and then goes for it.
Scooping them up. Yep. I love it.
But the particular picture that that National Geographic posted, obviously to the caliber of National Geographic, is absolutely beautiful. It's one of my favorite wildlife pictures that I've seen in the last year.
Yeah.
And so I had to Google it just to see if I could find other pictures or just more information about them.
Yeah.
And I came across an article called, here we go, 10 of the most sneakiest, most conniving animals in the world.
Dang.
I was at work, but work stopped at this point.
That's pretty dope. I like it, man. That kind of shit is the best. See, this is what I'd like to do. That bird you just described, I want to let it just like evolve for 1,000 years and then see what comes out of like, can you imagine? This is my pastime, by the way. Yeah, when I see a smart animal, I'm like, if that was the main animal on this planet, this is just in my own head. I'll spill like, if I'm waiting for a bus is what's happening in my head. Like, what would happen? Because this thing is vicious. Like, it's smart.
Mm-hmm.
That type of intelligence, or you've seen the dolphins that make like an air bubble around fish.
Right, yeah.
And the fish have to jump out of the air bubble and just snatch them right out of the air.
Mm-hmm.
That kind of stuff, you're like, huh, they're catching up.
Yeah.
I didn't think of that. Dude, if somebody gave you an umbrella and a spear, you'd be like...
Catch fish. Why what? With these things?
Yeah. You'd be trying to scoop them up with the bottom of the umbrella. You know you would.
Yeah, actually, I would.
Of course.
Yeah.
This thing's badass.
This is much better. So, obviously, it's a top 10 list.
Of course.
So, you get. Remember Cracked?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's all lists.
It's all lists, and you can't stop.
How high is this guy on the list?
Oh, he's number one.
What was the title of the article again?
10 of the most sneakiest, most conniving animals in the world.
Okay.
So, number one, black heron.
Makes sense.
Okay. So I want to go through most of them. Okay.
You want to go bottom up or top down?
No, we just keep going. Okay. Number two, Livingstone's cichlid killed by playing dead. So essentially a cichlid is a fish. Okay. Actually, same family as my guys over there in the aquarium there.
Yes, cichlids.
And what he does is he plays dead. He flops around.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe he gurgles a little bit.
Okay.
And then, and then when someone comes around to pick him up,
yeah,
he like acting, and then eats the fish.
What?
Yeah,
it eats that other fish.
When the fish comes to pick up the supposed carcass of the cichlid, he perks back up and gobbles up the scavenger.
You better hope whatever's coming to eat you isn't bigger than you. Like, wait, hold on. I'm like, are people? I think small. Oh, I see. So things smaller than it are coming to eat the body.
Yeah.
This can backfire, fish.
I'm just saying. It's not a well thought out plan.
It's not as conniving as you think. I'll just pretend to be dead and nothing bad will happen. Not that everything in here eats everything.
All right. Topi antelope.
Okay.
Cries wolf for sex.
Huh?
All right, here we go.
Also, an idea that can backfire dramatically.
All right, here we go.
Yeah.
Topi antelope are a common species of an ungulate.
Yep. That's like all deer, elk, all those guys with hooves are ungulates.
Mm-hmm. I'm very satisfied with myself that I knew how to pronounce that.
I'm glad you did.
Thank you, my friend. From Africa, with a complex social structure. Complex enough where the males, like the human variety, are prone to telling outrageous lies in order to improve their chances at sex. In order to keep,
I'm a wolf.
in order to keep females nearby during a very short the rut.
Yeah.
Like during the rut.
So if anybody doesn't know, rut is basically when your deer goes insane and it can't control itself when it comes to mating. It just needs to hump everything. And it's a very specific time.
They're making noise. They're yelling.
They're snarling. They're drooling. They're jizzing uncontrollably.
It's a ridiculous state of being.
Just be glad humans don't have... Imagine, it's like, shit, March is coming. Ruin all my underwear. Anyways, it would help like people get married though.
Yeah.
But bro, why'd you marry? Dude, it was a rut. I don't know what I was doing. All right. Just honoring the rut. It would make things so much easier. But tell me more about this wolf.
It would. Okay. All right. Here we go. In order to keep females nearby, mm-hmm. a recent study observed male topi they sound off a fake alarm call. So basically, whenever a female topi looks like they might start to wander away, the males yell the equivalent of, oh my God, lion, for the sole purpose of keeping their sex partners from running into the arms of some antelope.
Wow. That is messed up. That is conniving. This is way better than the fish, by the way. I would rate him. He's closer to the hearing because he's a freaking conniving asshole. Like, this guy's an asshole.
Yeah, that's...
He's not even doing it for, like, food. He's just like, hey, man, all of you are mine. Lion?
It's just as a question. When he yells it out, he's not even...
Just in case one of the girls like, dude, where's the lion? He's like, I was asking.
Right? You know what? Yeah. You don't want to commit to it, right?
Yeah.
He's like, no, I was just asking a question. Did you say lion? I thought you said lion. Here we go. Squaws. I don't know if I'm saying this right. Squaws are airborne pirates. Okay.
What? You're just going to end there as a description?
So what they do is... I like the article because they say stuff like completely devoid of honor. Squaws think of nothing but stealing chicks and eggs from their mothers.
Oh, well, that's terrible. So it's a bird.
Yep. So it's most of its diet is derived from mid-air robbery. Their favorite tactic, and also they do this in teams, is to fly around and harass fellow seabirds to the point where they vomit up their catch.
Huh.
Mm-hmm. The technical term for this behavior is kleptoparasitism. In case you were looking for a perfect word to describe certain members of your own family.
That's a habitual stealer.
That makes other people
throw up so that you can eat their food.
Yep.
God bless you.
At this point.
Yeah. I thought I was mad at the ungulate earlier for, but I was like, this guy, he's a bigger asshole.
Right.
This article is titled wrong, by the way. It should be called Assholes in the Animal Kingdom.
Cuckoo bees are traitorous usurpers.
Tell me.
Okay. Hold on, let me just, so they're essentially a parasite. Okay. So first the, cuckoo female finds a suitable hive full mm-hmm. of unsuspected dupes.
Okay.
Right. She will either sneak in and wait, to acquire the smell of other bees or go straight to the queen and murder her straight away. Okay.
Hmm.
If there is any suspicion, the cuckoo queens are built tough enough to survive and triumph in confrontations with all the workers. Like they got jiu-jitsu.
Jiu-jitsu.
yeah.
Well, I don't know. I'm just saying. I've pictured it in my head. There's wings involved. Keep going.
Right. Once the invading mother gets their eggs laid, the hives will take over all work over the Koku baby care.
Wow.
Right? So the hive, they don't even know. They're like, right. new eggs.
Yeah.
Let's treat them well. And then eventually those hatch.
Yeah.
And then they go up and kill everything else.
You know what's funny? That this is his bee style. Like, this is what it's been doing. Like, while other bees just, you know, we get honey, we travel around, we get resources. Like, oh, this is what spreading all of my kind does.
Yeah. Just like, right? You know what? It's almost like the entire race of bees,
yeah,
just bees,
right,
are too nice.
Mm-hmm.
So they need an Isis.
Right.
Just to balance it out.
Okay, Yasin.
Or something. Sure. Because normally, always, bees are always like, they're like, oh, we're moving along, we're pollinating stuff.
I don't want to go back to comparisons, but we can do this comparison. If Isis, what they were doing, was anything like what this bee's doing, right? This bee is not capturing other bees and put them in cages and burning them.
It was only for comedic.
I understand.
All right, fair enough.
It's bee Isis, though.
It's bee Isis.
This is as bad as a bee do.
This is as bad as a bee do, yeah.
That makes sense.
The cherry on top,
yeah,
is that sometimes if there's eggs from the actual hive,
mm-hmm,
they'll go and eat those eggs and then replace them with their own.
Jeez.
This
is not good.
All right. brown trout fakes orgasms. I didn't actually read this one.
Yeah.
So let's explore this together.
It's like, oh, your girlfriend's a brown trout. The signs were there.
She's got gills. All right. Trout sex can be a tricky
affair. How do they know?
Hold on. Let's find out.
Okay.
Let's find out. Tricky affair. They've been timing. Hold on a second.
That's funny.
You know what? It's a little too long. Someone can get there. I'm just not going to...
I didn't realize fish had orgasms, so this is already, like, educational,
right,
for me.
We're going to move on to number 8. A pearl fish that lives inside the host's, yes, anus.
Yes.
And then occasionally nibbles on its gonads.
Mm-hmm. I've seen this video, by the way.
Okay. So a pearl fish is a parasite. However, it's also a fish. And it lives... It lives its life abusing the lowly sea cucumber.
Mm.
What it does to a sea cucumber.
Which is a creature, not a cucumber, to the people who don't know about the cucumber of the sea.
Right. Is that it lives inside the cucumber, specifically, uh-huh, its butt.
In the butt? In the butthole?
In the butthole.
Oh, man.
Usually they're content in poking their heads out
of the butthole.
Of their cozy rectal hidey hole.
Hoo-hoo.
And feed on whatever's nearby.
Probably poop. No.
That would be a safe assumption.
This is a terrible place to live.
Terrible place to live.
But the rent.
But location. All right.
Imagine if you were a sea cucumber and you were like, did something just go in my butt? And then you'd be like so much more afraid.
Oh, boy. If there's not enough food, fish... That's fine. What was it called again?
This pearl.
Pearl fish, yeah. Pearl the fish. Pearl fish will turn around,
uh-huh,
and then eat through the abdominal wall,
ugh,
of the sea cucumber and then feast on its gonads. That is a horrible situation.
Did it say feast or did you say feast?
And
isn't that up to interpretation? Pearl fish like, I'm eating nuts down here. What do you mean feast? Like,
every time I hear, when I see the word feast, it's, yeah, like, you know, he duns like a, yeah, like he puts a napkin,
like a bib
in his shirt.
On, yeah, yeah. Get a right. fork and a knife. Like, ready to eat lobster.
Get a good pairing wine.
And he's like, this is my last ditch effort to stay alive, asshole.
I don't want to do this.
Yeah. When I say asshole, I mean home.
All right. Butterflies act cute, but actually steal turtles' tears.
Oh.
Okay.
That's fucked up, by the way.
It is. The pictures are even worse. So you never thought that butterflies would be mean, but they're definitely mean. So in the Amazon, sodium is sometimes in short supply. And so in order to get this, butterflies will gleefully molest other animals to gain access to their delicious salty tears.
Mm.
While some animals, like parrots, congregate around mineral deposits to gain access to minerals,
mm-hmm,
like normal things, you know, like, oh, it's a pool, it's, yeah, got high minerals, let's tell our friends we'll just sip from this water.
Right.
Not the way how the butterfly do. The butterfly apparently prefers to take advantage of other turtles' sadness.
Oh, man. How does it make them sad?
Or it just keeps like flapping around and making them like frustrated. And it must be easy because turtles don't move that quick.
Right.
And then the turtles start crying.
They've been living for like 80 years and now this shit's happening.
Right. They start crying. And after the butterfly's like, yes, this is what I was looking for. Your tears. Literally feasting on
the tears.
This is
the closest thing to a Death Eater that I've ever seen, where like this creature has to make you sad to live. That's what they do. That is the most messed up.
Yeah, and there's no amount of chocolate eating for this turtle is going to make him feel
any
better.
It's an insect, man. People have a weird fascination with like things that fly, and butterflies look beautiful. Mm-hmm. Just like birds. Mm. That's an insect. That's just like an ant or a butt-eating...
No feelings.
No.
No feelings.
It doesn't care.
Right?
You ever been to the botanical gardens in Niagara?
No, I have not. There's a butterfly aviary? Is that what they're called?
No. It's a...
conservatory.
Yeah, it's a conservatory. It's a biodome, basically, just full with really cool, colorful plants and butterflies. I mean, thousands of them. Mm-hmm. We should check it out.
All right, we'll go.
And we should just...
All right, that's what... Yeah, it's actually called that. Yeah. Butterfly Conservatory.
Conservatory. Stay in a good mood, though, apparently. And they leave, like, little...
Like just walk in there with, like, pepper spray.
Right.
He's like, come!
Yeah. Can you imagine? If, like, we just cried before going in, butterflies are all over us, and we're just like... That's right. Everybody's like, those guys have a way with butterflies.
It'd be great for the vlog, man.
And we'll be like, I'm so sad. They aren't even making me happy somehow. So confused.
Oh, man. All right. Maybe.
I thought you would have they might have this in Mauritius, mm-hmm. because I have them in Pakistan.
Yeah.
There's these lizards, and they live in your, like, tube lights.
They live everywhere.
They live everywhere.
In the house, yeah.
In
yeah.
the house.
Yeah.
But if you ever take a tube light out, there's three of them. And they get startled. And this is what I've noticed. Sometimes one of them will break their tail off. Mm-hmm. And they will run away. But the tail will just flap around like crazy. Mm-hmm. It's just spazzing out.
Yeah, yeah.
And the lizard will run away with no tail. Mm-hmm. And then later grow. You can see like lizard. You're like, look, it's growing a small tail that's getting bigger.
He was just in a scrap.
This is the most messed up thing I've ever seen was one lizard freak out, leave its tail, run away. And another lizard run over and eat the tail. Mm. And I almost threw up.
Hey man, it's free protein.
It is.
It's hard yeah. being a lizard in a house. In Mauritius, we have them too. I've never seen, well, because I haven't lived there long enough.
Mm-hmm.
And the thing is that there used to be more lizards in the houses back in the day.
Yeah.
But like more recently, I think, you know, they have traps and a bunch of other things. So like there's barely any lizards on the inside. Right. I've never seen one that detaches the tail.
Oh man.
But
they're regular.
There was one thing that was nasty.
What?
Okay. So they had a doorbell. This was back in like 1996, oh, man. Right?
As soon as you see a doorbell, I imagine all the worst things that can like you can do with a doorbell and lizards.
So it's not the actual where the ding dong is.
Okay.
Right? It's like in the house somewhere, there's the unit where the...
Oh, where the noise comes from.
Where the noise comes from,
I know what you mean.
And so it's like, it's a casing, but it doesn't work.
Mm-hmm.
And so my dad being the handyman,
right?
And back then my grandparents were still alive. Mm-hmm. And so they said, oh, you know, we've been having troubles with the doorbell. Mm-hmm. My dad's like, yeah, you having troubles? No problem. I got you. Yeah. Right? So, you know, he gets a stepladder, gets his tools or gets someone's tools and then takes the case out.
Mm.
When he takes the case out,
yeah.
Not only is it filled with ants,
mm-hmm.
right? But there was lizard eggs in there.
Man.
And there was lizards.
Oh, shit.
Suffice to say, the bell didn't work. We just had to take it all apart.
Right. We burned the house and we moved. That's what happened. That's the end of that story.
But it was a community.
Yeah.
In the doorbell unit. Man,
that's fucked up.
So that's when I saw.
That's
one of my more scary or uncomfortable memories of Mauritius.
Mm-hmm.
Was back in 2001 when I was there. Was it 2006? I forgot. 2006. I was in bed, you know, trying to fall asleep. And then you hear tick, tick, tick. And I'm like, there's something walking on the floor. And you know what? Like, it was linoleum. So, like, linoleum is really like clickety clackety.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Like, you can
it
hear
travels.
A lot. Right. I'm like, maybe it just go away.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah.
Because it wasn't in the room beforehand. Right.
Right.
Tick, tick. I'm like, what? The fuck is it in my room? Now the thing is that it's pitch black.
Right.
And this is back in the day where you didn't have a cell phone because you would normally reach over, get a cell phone, you get yourself a light. Mm-mm. Also, just letting you know, if there's something in your room that is not scared of lights,
noise.
No, not scared of a light, but actually attracted to it.
Right.
You don't want to be in that situation where now you are attracting the thing that's inside your room that likes lights.
Yeah.
Anyway, just a, you know, a survival tip there.
Did you find it?
Okay, so no, here's the thing, right? So the bed is here. Remember back in the day when you were a kid, the floor is lava?
Right.
Okay, relive that moment. Okay. Because the thing is that I knew it was on the ground.
Yeah.
So you just don't have to touch the ground. But I need to get to the light switch.
Right.
So from the bed, kind of hanging on to like the wardrobe, step onto a table and then flick the light on. Mm-hmm. Right dead center in the room is a cockroach.
Oh, man.
Now, pause for a moment.
Heavy enough to make footsteps.
There you go.
What the hell? And it smiled at me and it kind of curled his mustache and it flew away.
So that was that.
Yeah.
But once when I saw him, I'm like, okay, I can deal with this. Mm. It's no big deal. As long as it doesn't fly.
Yeah.
Okay. Because if you think it's like a cockroach that's walking on linoleum floor, you can hear. When they fly, by the way, a cockroach is like yay big, right?
Right.
When they fly, they sound like a mini helicopter.
Right. So anyway, it's very intimidating.
It very is.
It's like, like you can hear him work to fly.
Yeah. There's like little muscles and tendons like working. Anyway, so I disposed of them the way how I normally dispose of cockroaches back in the day. You go get a broom. The broom is it's made out of plants.
Okay.
It's like a... Like they take
a bunch
like
of sticks?
Kind of. Yeah, yeah.
Like a bunch of... Oh, okay. So this it almost feels like sticks have been stripped of everything.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, we have the same thing. Okay. I call it a jhadu. What do you call it?
In my head, broom.
In Mauritius. Like, what do they call it there?
In Creole? I don't know. I'm assuming they just call it balier. Balier? Yeah, I think so. But they don't call it by, like, the origin plant. They call it by what its function is, so they call it a broom.
Possibly.
Anyway.
I don't want to tell you what your country calls things, you know?
So I go get it.
Yeah.
And then kind of like just slide them around.
Right.
Until you like get to the door.
You're playing some floor hockey.
Flick them out. Yeah.
Right.
That's basically what you do.
Jeez, man.
Cats love that. When they find a cockroach,
they
love it. They flip it over and then they just like bat it around.
Yeah. I've seen a cat become a cat. Like it's an indoor cat.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't act like a cat.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden this moth comes in the house and it's a cat.
Yep.
And it jumped. I saw a cat jump, and no exaggeration, 10 feet in the air, like much higher than me off of a run to get a moth.
Yep.
And I just, like, I was just blown away.
Right. I mean, for us to even, like, if I told you immediately right now, say it, stand up, I want you to jump as high as you can.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Not the height's not going to be a thing.
No.
Before that,
right.
You're like, hold on, I got to stretch for a bit.
Right.
Right,
yeah.
Because you can't just ask someone to jump that high.
Are you kidding me?
No, you're just like
I gotta do things. Like I gotta do things too.
Right, and a cat like he could be sleeping
right
for the entire day,
mm-hmm.
see a moth and goes, I'm gonna jack that shit out of that at 10 feet, no problem.
That's what we don't realize is that since we don't interact with animal constantly, we don't realize that what an animal is capable of, like getting from spot A to spot B.
Mm-hmm.
Like, we understand a dog or a small cat to a certain extent,
yeah.
but we've never seen a greyhound, a normal one, just get mad or spooked and run away.
Because
I've seen one greyhound get spooked without a leash,
and
he ran away in a way that it was almost cartoonish. I was like, there's no way that thing just left that quickly. Because the owner was just checking their mail, and we were just outside the building, and a guy honked. And this thing just got scared and ran away around the corner.
Mm-hmm.
And it was, in like, less than 2 seconds, it had covered... what it would take me 10 seconds to run really hard, like with the full...
With like, full conviction.
And the owner looked at me. I'm like, your dog's gone. That's all I could say. I didn't say it ran away. I'm like, it's gone. Did you see that? Like,
it was here.
Yeah.
It
ran away, which would be me assuming a lot more about what I just saw. Because I just saw it disappear. So... And that's why I called you yesterday. And I was like, do you know how fast a cheetah is? Off the top of your head. I didn't even ask you any pre-questions. Like, hey, bro, off the top of your head, do you know how fast a cheetah is?
The answer to that question is about 100 kilometers an hour. That's at top speed.
Up. Yeah, 100 to 120 is what I saw on Google. That's what it said. 1 to 120.
It can only sustain that speed for about a minute to 2 minutes, though. As if that takes away from that.
Right. That seems like a long time. I can plank for what? I can be extremely still for 1 minute and then my back hurts. This thing is redlining.
It's like I was trying to make myself feel better. Like, but he can only run 100 kilometers for about a minute to two, really. So like,
I could plank for that long.
All right, so I have some facts.
Yo, so one thing I think about both of us, we love animal facts.
Yeah.
And I didn't know a lot about cheetahs, and you were like my favorite animal. So I'm like, save it.
We'll talk about it on the podcast. All right, so the cheetah. Mm-hmm. Is the only cat that cannot fully retract its claws.
Hmm.
And the reason for that is for traction.
Right.
So it can run.
Yeah.
So that's pretty damn cool.
Yeah.
The cheetah's got these two stripes on its face.
Yes.
And that is to reduce the reflection of the sun. Because a cheetah has to chase prey. Mm. It doesn't overpower anything.
Right.
It has to chase.
Right.
So...
And it's chasing the fastest thing.
Like, yeah, undulates.
Undulates.
And something like an antelope, mm-hmm. they change directions very quickly in hopes to lose its prey.
Yeah.
Or the predator.
Right.
And so the cheetah needs to change directions a lot.
Yeah.
And it can't factor in the sun. Mm. So like where a lion or a tiger would attack in such a way that, you know, the sun doesn't become an issue,
mm-hmm.
right? A cheetah can't really, you know, plan for that because he needs to roll with the punches.
Right.
So... because of the fact that they had to change direction so quickly, they have like this permanent football, like the American football
players.
That's
how they get it. That's how the football players got it.
Yeah, they got it from cheetahs. So, and that reduces the glare quite a bit. Mm-hmm. So it can consistently see its prey even when it needs to change directions. Mm-hmm. That's not all, bro.
No.
It's got a very heavy tail.
Right. Mm-hmm. Right. Yeah. Because it's in play when it's running. I've noticed that. I'm like, what are you doing?
Yeah. It has to counterbalance or counteract. So when it's doing a quick turn, it swings the tail in the opposite direction for it to be able to break its momentum and make the turn. It's such a purpose built machine for this one thing. What is the best way for a cat to run out of super fast prey? And then it was designed in a way that's just the most efficient way.
Scary as shit, but beautiful. But is it smart though?
Is
it doing nefarious things like living in people's buttholes and no?
No. It's not like killer whales.
Okay.
Have you seen killer whale hunting?
Killer whales, you almost lose all compassion for them once you see them playing around with their food. You're like, oh, they trapped this baby seal and now they're not gonna kill it. They're just gonna bat it around.
No, they do that so that they can help the young learn how to hunt.
Yeah, it helps to learn. It helps them be assholes. Like, just hunt it.
No, you
let them go hunt it.
And then you're like, okay, junior, try to.
We saw different videos. I saw one where this killer whale, using its back tail, punted the seal out of the air.
No, that was. Are you sure?
Oh,
I thought that
positive.
Was a whale, like a big whale.
No, it's a killer whale.
Okay,
it's these people are so playful with their food. It's stupid. And they're smiling the whole time. I don't know if they are, but this seal, you can check it on YouTube, about 40 to 50 feet in the air.
Okay.
Spinning sideways.
Okay.
And it splats down. And they're still just moving around.
That is, my friend.
An asshole fish.
The law of the jungle.
Right. Okay. The jungle of the water.
That's the way how that goes. And I've seen one where... there's a seal that's on a piece of ice that's floating, a pretty big piece of ice. And they're trying to get the seal to fall into the water so that they can eat it.
Right.
And they eventually figured out that they could just make waves, which will bob the thing, and then it will lose its balance and fall into the water.
So if I was I like to put myself in the place of these seals sometimes.
Okay, go ahead.
I'm just thinking... you're surrounded by killers. Yep. All you have is this little piece of ice that's melting slowly.
Yeah.
And then they figure out to bob the water.
Yep.
And at that point, you're like, all right, this is the food chain.
Yeah.
And that's, then you just
fall into the realization.
When you're young, you see these shows and they talk about animals, right? They'll show an animal, it gets its food, or they show its mating habit.
Yeah.
And that's it. You move on to the next animal.
Yeah.
In the late 90s, they started doing this thing where like, oh, we're following this pack of, you know, lions or something. And like an hour in, there's been a fire. This group got separated. And then the guy in the British accent goes, Simba won't make it this summer. And then it'll explain why. It'll just be like, you know, it's got a limp. Its mother lost a tooth, so she's definitely going to die. And it's just like, oh, man, the animal kingdom is not what I expected whatsoever. This is a rough place to live.
Are you referring to...
everything, really, but yeah.
It's true. Like, Africa is what I'm watching currently.
Africa's the most brutal. That's probably why.
Oh, God. Yeah. I just saw the episode where an elephant, mom and baby.
Yep.
And then they just... There's not enough food. There's not enough milk in the mom. There's not enough nutrients, and this baby's gonna die.
Yeah,
and you watch.
You watch
as this baby just like goes from walking to like sitting to laying down, and then the mom just has to wait. She's trying to help, but she's not gonna leave her kid behind. Right. So waits until her baby dies, and then continues to pack. And you're watching this, and like I'm like, If you were the camera people, like if you're the crew, how like don't you want to like throw a bottle of water?
You're like, I think I'm adopting a baby elephant. Bring it home. It's wearing a cardigan.
Jeez, and the way how they like, you know, they tell a story, which is fascinating.
Yeah.
All right, you had animal facts of your own that you brought today.
I'm just in a sad place.
That's why I'm trying to bring you up.
Yeah, I guess so, man. I guess so. It's not working.
It's not working.
One thing I did want to say, because you did talk about the antelope and the cheetah chasing the antelope with the tail. I talked to you a little bit about this in terms of, you know, there used to be a North American cheetah that got extinct a while back. But the antelopes here are still here, and they're faster than any other predator. That's why people hunt them a lot more, because nothing else kills them.
Wait, we have antelope?
Not in Canada, but in... the southern part.
Okay.
The U.S. has a lot of, like, in Montana and out west, there's
antelope.
Yeah.
Interesting.
And they're, the one thing I did read about but didn't tell you was a short-faced bear. And it's similar to a...
I've heard about this.
Okay, so it's a bear with a blockier head. The thing that, it's not really, it's much bigger, and was able to figure out because of its bone structure that it was a sprinter.
Okay, much bigger than what?
Much bigger than a polar bear. A polar bear is the biggest bear out right now. It's bigger than a black bear in the new models. And the spoilers. But a polar bear is bigger than a grizzly.
Really?
So a polar bear standing on like a hind legs. Oh, yeah, yeah.
Really?
And also because polar bears are just way more aggressive because they can only eat... A polar bear cannot eat any vegetation.
Because there's none.
There's none. There's nothing that grows up here.
Right. Well, it kills everything with its face.
Well, grizzly bears, they go like ups and downs of eating fatty things and then just eating like, you know... blueberries and stuff like that.
Like we're just seven,
But a polar bear is just way more aggressive. So the short-faced bear used to actually hunt and sprint after things.
And then, bigger than the biggest bear that's currently alive.
Exactly. And the guy who was, there was a conservationist who was talking about this, a really smart guy. And the host asked him, like, what's the craziest way you ever seen a bear kill something?
Yeah.
And he was like, I was in Eastern Canada, and I saw a bear... stalk a moose, and this moose was like, you know, you could tell the moose hadn't eaten in a while. It was like looking, and it found some food it was eating. And he said the bear ran up to it and hit it with his hand, like with his claw, and broke the moose's back. And the moose collapsed, and the bear ate it slowly.
All right. So for those of you people who don't know, and I don't think because most of our listeners are from Canada, but a moose is the size of a Honda Civic.
It's like a horse and a half.
Yes.
Yeah. And a bear judo chops this thing and breaks his back. And I couldn't believe it, so I Googled it. Apparently, they have the power in their claw to do that. They could just break a moose's back. And I'm supposed to lay down and act dead? Like...
Yeah, what's the rules? There's multiple rules for multiple bears. Do you know them?
I don't know the... You can look them up.
Do that right now.
So, and I could be wrong, but I might be right. So a brown bear... which is your grizzly, which is a more aggressive bear. You know what? I shouldn't guess in case some dude listens.
It's like applying what he learned on Crash and Flow.
So you have your brown bear, which is a grizzly, and then you have your black bears. And if you're around a polar bear, then you just die. I don't. You've been
no. That is the one for sure. The one for sure is that in the scenario that you're being attacked by a polar bear,
yeah,
you can only run,
mm-hmm.
and you probably will die.
Yeah. So put up a good fight.
Yeah, yeah.
That's
put
all
up,
we're
put
saying
up a show
with you, the polar bear, because yeah. that thing doesn't care. It's not telling to sell you Coke or anything. Trust me. Which one are we looking up first?
I'm hoping I can find an article that will show like all types of bears.
Okay.
So. Here we go. I got it. Okay. Grizzly bear.
Right.
How to survive a grizzly bear? Carry pepper spray. Shit. you are on bad.
Right.
You're like, it's not looking good if point number one is.
Don't
like,
be around the bear.
You could have at least. Oh. Like, it's like, have a RPG.
Right.
Okay. So carry pepper spray. Bear pepper spray. Do not run. When you run, the bear thinks that you're prey. I feel like if I'm still, it will also think that I'm prey, but it will continue to chase you. So stand your ground. Don't think that you can outrun a bear because they can run 30 miles per hour unless you're Usain Bolt. I threw that one in myself. Okay, so what you're supposed to do is drop down onto the ground in a fetal position.
And this is a black bear, you said?
No, grizzly.
This is a grizzly, so a brown bear or a grizzly. Okay.
Right. Yes. Drop down in the fetal position and play dead.
All right.
The problem with this, mm-hmm. I mean, it's not a problem. Obviously, this is the thing that's going to, like, might save your life.
Right.
But the thing is that a grizzly bear's claw is about, like, yay big, yay wide.
Yeah,
and so when it's prodding you, it's not like a...
Yeah. It's hurting you.
Yeah. That's what I'm saying. While he's just doing stuff to you, like, we are soft creatures. And him just like moving you around a little bit is like punctured lung, broken rib, and you know, that type of thing. So you need to like
now
really work hard on being dead. All right, here we go. Black bear. Point number one.
Yep, pepper spray.
Thank you. Point number two, stand your ground and make a lot of noise.
Right.
Yeah.
So this is the one you act tall, you lift your hands up and you go, bah, bah. Mm-hmm.
They oftentimes they bluff their attack.
So they like charge you.
Yeah.
But
so
don't.
So what you need to do is that you got to show that you mean business and it might back down. Do not climb a tree.
Right. I've seen videos of this.
Yes. Yeah. And if, all else fails, fight back.
That'd be fun.
Use anything that you can find around you as a weapon. Aim blows to the face, particularly the eyes or the snout. When a black bear sees its victim, sees that their victim is willing to fight to death, they'll usually give up.
I'd love to fight a bear with a stick.
Okay, go on.
Well, I mean, okay, let's say if there's no holographic world, is it gonna hurt? What, like, what?
Okay, I
would
what
love
saying.
To fight a bear.
Yep.
What else would you love to fight?
Mm-hmm.
For me, it's bear, and then it's actually a cheetah or something.
I
don't want to fight a gorilla. I don't want to say I beat a gorilla, but I'd love to say, yeah, I fought a bear. And guess what? It played dead. It knew its role. Like, shit. Act big, play dead.
So here's the thing, though. What are you going to get out of that?
The experience of fighting a bear.
Okay.
I would just love to fight a bear. I think that'd be a fun fight.
Mm-hmm.
If you can fight a bear and not die, that'd be a fun experience.
I hear tell Habib Nurmagomedov.
Nah, not really.
He didn't fight
a bear. So what they used to do in Dagestan is that Habib Nurmagomedov, we're butchering it. Just call him Habib.
Habib, yeah.
Nurmi, Habib, he's from Dagestan, and he's an MMA fighter in the UFC, and as a youth, his dad made him wrestle a bear. Truth be told, the man wrestled a bear.
Okay.
He did that. But in Dagestan, what they do is when you're young, they bring in a bear cub, which is bigger than you, but this bear cub is still young enough not to have teeth.
I see.
If you ever want to see what a bear cub can do in terms of fighting, Google bear cub versus dog. Like a full-grown dog, and you will see a bear cub throw around a dog like this bear cub's been doing judo all of its life. So, like, it's still a bear cub is still a powerful being.
Yeah, yeah.
No teeth, though, so.
Okay, that's fair.
Right.
But the thing is that if the story of your people,
mm-hmm.
your the
your Spartan story.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. What's it called? The coming of age? No, that's not the one I'm looking for.
Okay,
it's a your rite of passage. Right. If the rite of passage for people from Dagestan is, we wrestle bears.
Yep.
There's not many things that are as badass as you being able to say the that sentence, right? My rite of passage was I wrestled a bear.
Right.
You don't have to offer up the fact that it doesn't have teeth. Right. Like you actually did wrestle a bear.
Did.
It's not easy.
It was. We were the same size.
Yep.
Hmm.
I would not want to fight. Even in in like a holographic VR thing, I think like I would. You know what? Maybe I'd graduate too.
Right.
But I would start very low.
All right. Hold on. We aren't gonna say the biggest of each creature, but like a decent sized bear, a decent sized wolf, a decent sized cat. Pick a, I guess a cheetah, jaguar, or a mountain lion. Which one would you like to go with?
Okay, for cat.
Yeah.
Who? Oh, okay.
Hold if on. You were to face one. Like one of these, I would probably pick. I learned a mountain lion is the strongest pound for pound, along with the domestic house cat is what
like George St. Pierre of the cats.
A domestic house cat is one of the strongest pound for pound. Mm-hmm. Like if it was bigger, it'd be a problem.
Right.
So
yes, I probably mountain lion just because there's a higher chance of me running into one.
Okay.
I'd probably go lynx because it looks a lot smaller.
Sorry, it's not big enough to qualify for this situation.
Okay, all right, fair enough.
You should be able to beat a lynx, sir. Just saying.
I think a house cat, if a house cat wanted to fuck you up, I think you would have a problem.
I've been fucked up by a house cat where I was scared of house cats for like a year because I pet it when it didn't want to be pet and it just clawed the crap out of my arm.
Right.
Like I was bleeding.
See, the thing is that what's not in the advantage of the cat is its initial approach. Right? So if it's across the room and it's running towards you, it's a very fast clip. But if you can get down a kick, you're pretty good. Like if you can land a good punt, you're good.
Just the distance it should create if you land it.
But if you miss and this thing goes into the inner thigh and starts biting you,
it will.
We've seen it.
Yeah.
Like it's a problem. Right. These little cats would be a problem.
What if you had a stick? Like you had a staff, like a Gandalf size, but like polished off martial arts staff.
Right.
Because in my scenario,
I win.
Me fighting any of these animals, I like to have a staff because I think that's fair. I think a man, we're soft, man. We're soft. We got no nails.
Soft as baby poop.
Yep. My teeth aren't like.
Not pointy enough.
No.
Nope.
You know what I can lift?
Yeah.
A staff or a gun.
I've had to swing at dogs.
With what?
With a stick in Mauritius.
See,
this is the reason why I'm thinking if I was armed with a stick, I'd be okay.
Yeah.
So back in the day, I'm pretty sure it's the same thing in Pakistan, but like just dogs just roam around.
Yeah.
And they run around in packs.
Yeah.
Specifically at night.
Mm-hmm.
So if you're gonna walk from one family's place back home,
yeah,
you gotta walk. Mm-hmm. There was a high chance that you would come across like a group of dogs.
Jeez.
For the most part, the dogs just ignore you
mm-hmm.
because. In third world country, people are really mean to animals.
Right.
They throw rocks at it, boiling water, all that shit. It's horrible.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But anyway, so most part, they have already learned their lesson because mm-hmm. of brutal, horrible human beings.
Right.
And they don't bug you. That being said, as a result of brutal, horrible human beings, mm-hmm. some dogs would really like to jack someone.
All right. They're aggressive.
And so you have to walk around with a stick.
Stick.
Yeah.
Jeez.
And so one came up, like it was like, it was coming up. So you do one of these like swings and whatnot. And then eventually it's just like, oh, yeah.
That's insane, man. There was a couple 2 years ago. It was in Australia. There was just an elderly couple that got jacked by dingoes, like a small pack of dingoes. Mm-hmm. And that's their wild dog.
Mm-hmm.
Some places have, every place had a wild dog. We called them, a dingo is actually a red wolf. Okay. It's an Indian red wolf that got to Australia, early settlers, and then it was hard to domesticate.
Mm-hmm.
Certain dogs are, and it just runs rampant now. But every place had one of these, and elderly people in certain countries get jacked by wild dogs like on a regular basis. We've been lucky because we've killed all of our animals to the point where we have no relationship with the animals around us.
Yep. The only relationship that we'll have is with raccoons.
Yeah.
Actually, there's a funny story.
Raccoons and squirrels.
So my parents, they They like to slow cook lamb. Mm. It's really great.
Oh, man.
So it takes about like 4 to 6 hours.
Tell me.
To cook in a crock pot. Yeah. The thing is that it gives off, it just smells like cooking food.
Yeah.
And the thing is, you don't want to have that in your house
right.
the entire day.
Yeah.
So what my dad does is he runs in the an extension cord, and then they plug it out outside. Mm. And so it just cooks outside for okay. 6 hours.
Right.
So at some point during the day, my dad, closer to Maghrib, I guess, sunset, my dad goes outside just to check the thing. Mm-hmm. And he's saying, like, literally, there was a raccoon sitting on his bum with his paw on the handle, and he was lifting and he was lifting the cover, like he was just trying to, like, you know,
yeah,
get the scent.
Like he was been cooking this the whole time. Oh, raccoons.
We had to throw away the food.
Yeah.
Yeah.
A raccoon, if you could domesticate a raccoon, I feel like you know when you can teach a dog to do a trick?
Mm-hmm.
I feel like you can teach a raccoon to do things that are actually helpful.
Yep.
Like, I'll be home by 4. Can you take the food out?
Have you seen the video where...
He just walks around.
Where what was it? It was like cat food or dog food or something. And he walks up and he grabs a handful and then waddles away on his 2 feet while he's holding
He's holding the food like a little... It's adorable.
Yep.
Those things are really interesting, by the way.
Yeah.
You don't give them enough credit.
There's a reason why they still exist in the urban environment.
And they live in like small, familiar packs.
Mm-hmm.
Like it's all relationship-based.
Yeah.
That's why they're always like going somewhere. They're always going... It's not just standing there like a squirrel. You know, just standing there eating.
Yeah.
It's like, as soon as it sees you see it, it's like, I know where to go. Like, I know where to, I need to, it doesn't run off. It just moseys there.
Yeah. Yeah. It's funny when you see them walking around.
Yeah.
They're big butts.
Okay.
Yep.
I didn't know that.
Because they like slant out like this. So when they waddle, it looks very funny.
Okay.
I always found it funny watching a raccoon walk away.
I look next time too.
Yeah, you should. It's a treat. Actually, there's an Instagram.
You make it sound weirder and weirder.
No, it's going to get weirder. Okay. I think there's an Instagram account that is that's called Corgi Butts.
Yeah. It's adorable. I've seen it. Corgis are just, come on. They're the one of the cutest of the dog variety.
Oh, there's something for everyone in Instagram.
Corgis are, if you just want a cute dog that's going to be like not too much work, but it's not tiny like a wiener dog. It's bigger than that.
Mm-hmm.
You don't get much cuter than a corgi. Plus, they're emotional. They like show their happiness and sadness and all of that. They jump around and shit.
I think I saw a... it was like a corgi husky.
Mm, like a... Oh, okay. I can
see
that.
It's a mini husky.
That's so cute. It's like in a disguise. It's like in a husky disguise is the way I see it in my head.
Yeah.
Oh, man.
Yeah. I think I looked at the pricing and it was about like $9,000 or something.
Hmm.
Not that I was going to buy it, but I know you've been looking for some sort of loophole.
Dude, I'll go hunting. I'll take it with me. I'll teach it to hunt.
Can you imagine you hunting with a corgi?
You're talking to somebody who's... Yeah, can you imagine? I make it wear a hat. I know what it's good for. It's not for this. It'd just be like in camouflage, like me. Give a little gun. It'd be my gun, but I let him wear it. Right. Just like as a hand pistol. Corgi. Shoot a bird. That'd be adorable.
You were going to say something about having a dog.
You're talking to a guy who's afraid of dogs, but I love dogs. Mm-hmm. I like every time I see a dog, I got questions for the guy who owns the dog. How old's your dog? What's it do?
Mm-hmm.
I love animals, but a dog. I know religiously we're not supposed to have one, and I'm gonna work fully within these confines to figure out how I can have one.
Is it? I think the Maliki Madhib is like,
yeah,
go nuts.
They're very open to it. The thing is, I feel like a dog adds so much to your life. Like, it's not just a matter of a companion or somebody you go on a hike with or a walk with. Every relationship you have in the house adds something. Like, the plants I have in the house that I water, that I trim, that I groom, that I pot and soil, like, it adds a lot to my life.
Sorry, you said that I pot and soil, and I just...
That's me birthing them. That's me.
Like, are you pooping on your plants, bro?
No, that's just, yeah, it's...
I soiled my plants.
It's a part of me in there. But when it comes to dog, I just feel like, man, you, you can love this thing, like the way you can love, let's say, a plant or something.
Yeah.
This thing loves you back.
Yeah, that's true.
And what you give to it in terms of affection and life and you, the way you train it, it gives you that stuff back to you. And it's like one of the few relationships between humans and something that's not human, that's, you know, a symbiotic on an almost a even playing field. And I feel like you don't get that with most other things. You get that with people relationships, but this thing loves you implicitly. You come home, you can be a shitty person as long as you're good to the dog. Even if you aren't great to the dog, like, this thing is so happy to have you there. Like, I don't know. I feel like I read a sign once outside of a pub and it said, be the person your dog thinks you are.
Oh, man.
And I was like,
it's so much responsibility.
That's how much dogs love you. And every time I have a friend, I go to their house and their dog is there. Like, this thing is, it loves them. I mean, I'm skittish around it, but I get better after a while. So,
unconditional love from a dog. The best way for you to think of this, or at least that I've found, is if you used to have, like, you know, you had a house, a car, a family, you know, a job.
Right.
Things were going good. You had the dog. Dog loves you 100%. Like, it loves you as much as it could ever love you during that time. You get divorced, you lose your job, you live on the street. That dog still loves you 100%.
True.
Like, it didn't go down.
Yeah.
It's always just on.
Your wife will leave you. If you lose your job, lose your house, because you became an alcoholic, you will always be like, I'm out. But your dog's like, I guess we live out here now.
And even a cat would leave you eventually. It's like, so we're not getting food? Right? So I'm going to go take care of myself. Whereas a dog will just hang with you. Until
ride or die, bitch.
Yeah.
Your dog is an actual ride or die, bitch. On that note.
Yeah, it's not going to get any better than that. Guys, thanks for listening. Thanks for joining. We have a lot of fun doing this. And so it means a lot that you guys, you know, take time out of your day or not. You know, do something while
they do. They send me messages like, I heard your last podcast. Sometimes that's all they say.
And that's all, like, that's all we need, really.
They're like, yes, it was good. I'm like, well, why'd I have to add?
Do you like me? Please like
me. But if you guys got questions or you guys have, like, honestly, suggestions, send them. Like, I'd love it. Like, people are so awesome. Everybody I've met through the podcast has been wonderful.
It's been great. Anyway, love you all. Hope you guys like what you heard.